Good day and welcome. This is the International Space Station Flight Control Room at the Johnson Space Center in Houston with the Expedition 29 update for Friday, October 28th. Flight Director Jerry Jason is leading today's team of flight controllers, and serving as spacecraft communicator at CAPCOM today is Kathy Bolt. This week, the Expedition 29 crew members and Commander Mike Fossum, Satoshi Furukawa, and Sergei Volkov completed preparations for the departure of the Progress 42 vehicle, including the packing of the vehicle with trash, testing the Russian segment's KURS automated rendezvous system for both the passive side of the Vesta service module and the active side of the Progress supply ship, and made preparations to close the hatch between the station and the vehicle. Progress 42 is set to undock on Saturday at 4:04 a.m. Central Time. With an eye towards undocking and deorbit of Progress 42, the crew today closed the hatch between the pier's docking compartment and the vehicle. That happened this morning at 9:25 a.m. Central Time, and then they began to conduct leak checks. Departure of the Progress 42 sets the stage for the arrival of the Progress 45 vehicle, a supply ship filled with 2.8 tons of food, fuel, and supplies. That supply ship will launch at 5:11 a.m. Sunday, 4:11 p.m. Baikonur time, and dock to the station on Wednesday, November 2nd at 6:40 a.m. Central Time. All of this can be seen on NASA television. Progress 45 and its Soyuz booster rolled to the launch pad today at the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan. The Progress 45 launch will be the first for this configuration of the Soyuz booster rocket since the third stage engine failure in the flight of August 24th. That failure resulted in the loss of that Progress cargo craft, the station's Progress 44. Earlier today, Volkov and Furukawa conducted a training session with the terabotically operated rendezvous system in the Vesta service module, that is the TORU, and is the manual system that would be used next week in the unlikely event that the new Progress 45 cargo craft encounters a problem with its automated rendezvous system, the KURS, for link up to the pier's docking compartment on Wednesday. During the crew's daily Earth observations, a time to capture video and photographs for scientists studying Earth's changes, this week the crew was able to video Hurricane Rina as the hurricane swept over southern Mexico. At its peak on Wednesday, Rina was near a Category 3 hurricane, but weakened Thursday as it closed in on Cancun and other resorts on Mexico's popular Caribbean coast. Rina is now a tropical depression. Hurricane Rina also impacted NASA's 15th Extreme Environment Mission Operations, or known as NEMO. The six Aquanauts of NEMO crew left the facility where they lived for 5 days and returned to the surface of the Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary in Key Largo on Wednesday. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, operates the Aquarius Undersea Laboratory, and the agency determined that Rina posed a risk to the safety of the mission taking place near Key Largo. In other activities for the week, Fossum worked on the binary colloidal alloy test, known as the BCAT experiment. This experiment lays the foundation for nanotechnology and nanomechanical systems in space and could apply to ceramics, composites, and optical filters here on Earth. Fossum also performed the SPRINT experiment, which evaluates the use of high-intensity and low-volume exercise training to minimize the loss of muscle, bone, and cardiovascular function in station crew members. This study will help a scientist plan longer missions, such as travel to an asteroid or to Mars. And Fossum also performed the final VO2 max experiment this week. This study evaluates oxygen uptake by crew members and relates to the ability of an astronaut to perform an egress task, the task required to abandon the station, while wearing a launch and escape spacesuit. And Japanese Space Agency astronaut Satoshi Furukawa completed work on the gradient heating facility in the Kobo module, closed out his nutrition assessment for the mission, and stored those samples in the station's minus 80-degree freezer, also known as the Melfi, set up equipment for additional biorhythm experiments this week, did some maintenance work on the water on and off valve, and installed egress markers around the Columbus module hatch. During the week, the crew was interviewed by CNN and MSNBC, talked with school children at the 19th International Space Olympiad, and with ZZ Top musician Dusty Hill and his family, and held several ham radio conferences with schools around the world. Furukawa also responded to questions from students at the Sega Space and Science Museum at the Takayama Astronomical Observatory. In other news this week, the Expedition 2930 crew, U.S. astronaut Dan Burbank and Russian cosmonauts Anton Shakhapurov and Anatoly Ivanishin, conducted a news conference at the Gagarin Cosmonaut Training Center in Star City, Russia, toured Red Square in Moscow, where they laid commemorative flowers at the Kremlin Wall, and began preparations to fly to the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan on Monday to get ready for their launch to the station on the Soyuz 28 at 10:14 p.m. on November 13th. For more information on the space station and Expedition 2930, be sure to look for the International Space Station homepage on the web. Find us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter at NASA_International Space Station or NASA_Johnson. This is Mission Control Houston.